Hello and welcome to Vigillo's How Will the Coming CSA Hazmat Changes Affect You webinar. So pleased to have everyone here. There are hundreds of people who have registered for this webinar. It's a hot topic. I'll be introducing Vigillo's CEO, Steve Bryan, in just a moment. Before we get into our analysis of proposed CSA 3.0 methodology changes. Before we get going, first I want to let you know that Steve Bryan's contact information is on the screen. We'll put it back again at the end of the webinar if you want to contact him directly with questions. For technical support, you can contact Vigillo support. Information is at the bottom of the screen. I do want to let you know there's been a lot of interest. We are recording this webinar, and we'll post the webinar recording and slides to the Vigillo blog as quickly as we can. That's typically within a day or two after the webinar. All right. To make this as smooth as possible for you, we're using a tool called GoToWebinar. The main area here, you can drag and expand to fill up your screen with the Maximize button. Also, there's a little sidebar here. To get rid of it, click that orange button, and it'll slide away and give you the most room to view things. I encourage you to do that. If you have a question at any point, you can pull out this screen. First, you can pick your audio mode, whether you use your telephone or the computer microphone and speakers. Additionally, here is a chat section, and if you have questions at any point during the webinar, just go ahead and type those in. We'll do our best to get to all questions at the end of the webinar. If we don't get to all of them by the end of the webinar, we'll contact you individually. But again, please feel free to enter questions at any point during the webinar. All right. And before we get over to Steve, let's just get a baseline of how people are doing on these proposed HAZMAT changes, SMS 3.0. We're going to run a quick survey. This is interactive. So please, the polls are open now. The question is, how much do you know about the coming CSA HAZMAT BASIC and SMS 3.0 changes? Pick the answer that's the best for you. Nothing, very little or just learning. Know some details or a few of the key changes. I understand the overview of SMS 3.0 changes, or I have a thorough understanding of details. It'll be interesting to see. We have a wide variety of people from across the North American continent. All right. Lots of people are voting. If you haven't gotten your vote in, just pick the answer that works best for you and click submit. Most votes are in. I'm going to give everyone about 20 more seconds. Again, the choices are nothing, very little just learning, know some details, understand the overview, or have a thorough understanding. Okay, looks like most votes are in. Let's go ahead and close that. Polls are closed, and here we can see what the answers were. For most people, it looks like the biggest answer was the middle one, 38%. I know some details or a few of the key changes, although 34% knows very little or just learning. So you can see most of us are in the middle here, but people on both ends of that spectrum. Thanks for sharing that information. And without further ado, let me introduce live from St. Petersburg, Florida, Vigillo's CEO, Steve Bryan.
Well, thank you, Sloan. Thank you very much. And that was an interesting poll. That's very helpful for me to know kind of where people's minds and hearts are before we get started here. So as Sloan just mentioned, I'm in St. Petersburg right now. I'm attending the American Trucking Association's leadership conference down here, where yesterday a safety meeting was held. The safety committee meeting was held, and a lot of fiery talk about CSA, specifically around this hazmat issue. So it's a real hot topic. The 10,000 foot view of this at this point in time, the reason this was to us critical to hold this webinar this week was the comment period that the FMCSA has laid out for people to submit comments to the docket at the FMCSA so that they can review what people think about this comes up on the 28th. So this is the last week. By the end of the weekend, that comment period will be over. So it's gratifying to see so many people focused on this, and hopefully we can get through a little bit of analysis here that will get you up the scale on the poll there and get you to a point where you can get those comments in. So Sloan, if you'll click to the next slide. Sloan, by the way, is driving this from our office in Portland, and I'm in Florida, so I think probably nearly everyone on the call is sandwiched somewhere in between us today, so hopefully our technology will hold up here. All right, so I'm going to start here, and this is as we begin this analysis, I think it's good for us to lay a foundation and understand what is it that CSA was designed, architected, engineered, and rolled out to do? What is its mission statement? I have three things on the screen here. First, kind of a what was in the past, what is current, and what's in the future. So what kind of has been our past, what we have lived under up to this point in time, is what's called CSA 2.2, the methodology that is in place today. That's what everybody's currently being measured by and operating under. That particular methodology, the published methodology, comes with a goal statement, a mission statement, and it reads in summary that it is the goal of CSA to reduce crashes, fatalities, and injuries on our nation's highways. Interestingly, when 3.0, the new preview proposed methodology, was published, it also contains a goal statement, which, except for a very few small wording changes, remains focused on reducing crashes, fatalities, and injuries on our nation's highway. Last week, the FMCSA published their 5-year strategic plan. And the little graphic at the bottom here, the image there, is lifted directly off of their 5-year strategic plan. And what does it start with? It is the mission of the FMCSA to reduce crashes, injuries, and fatalities on our nation's highways. So I like to start here because we're going to circle back to this at the end. And this entire analysis is done under a lens of trying to keep true to the mission of CSA. And again, one more time, to reduce crashes, fatalities, and injuries on our nation's highways. Well, Sloan, if you'll move that ahead. So the first question, we're going to address kind of two questions, is kind of a what and a why. So what changes? What is it that is being done that takes us from a world of this 2.2 methodology to 3.0? And these are the salient points here, that we have taken all of the non-HAZMAT cargo violations and lifted them out and carried them over and dropped them into the vehicle maintenance basic. What that leaves behind, bullet point two, is that what was called cargo before is renamed HAZMAT. It now contains those left behind violations that are HAZMAT related, and all of the other cargo violations are now citizens of the vehicle maintenance basic. The third point is we then introduce 115 new HAZMAT violations that go into that new HAZMAT basic. So this is really important for people to focus on, is these are 115 new violations that up to this point in time were never counted anywhere in CSA. Now, they're not new violations. They exist in the regs, but they have never existed in the CSA system before. There's also three new that were added to maintenance. There were 11 that were removed, 6 from maintenance and 5 from cargo. The net effect of that is what we are now left with is we still have 7 basics. Cargo no longer exists as a basic. That has been replaced by HAZMAT, and 115 new violations in, 11 out. The net effect, where we do today, we have 695 total violations that make up CSA, and we now have, under the 3.0 preview, proposed methodology change, we will now be tracking 802 violations. That's about a 15% increase, and I will raise the first, I guess, yellow flag and call everyone's attention. Whenever brand new things are introduced into a system, it's worth taking notice, focusing very closely to see what it is, what caused that, what was the thinking behind bringing 115 new violations in. And we'll talk a little bit more about that. Next. So that was the what, and now we're going to talk a little bit about the why. Why did this change get introduced. So what we're going to do is we have taken the data that we have. Vigillo has access to data on several thousand carriers, so we've looked at this and run a comparison. The why, the stated reason that the FMCSA has put forth as to why they revisited this, was to address the unfair bias that exists against those in the flatbed segment of the industry. If you are one of those operators, or even if you're not, I'm sure you can understand the bias that existed. The cargo's open, it's exposed, it's visible to enforcement, and a lot more violations get written on flatbed than on other closed-in box-style trucks. So what we did was we went and looked at all the data that we had, and we said, well, let's see if that bias, in fact, really existed. So what we've done at Vigillo is we have created a sub-segment. We identified about 24,000 carriers that are at least partially or wholly flatbed operators. And we lifted them out and ran their CSA basic scores against the rest of the industry left behind after we removed the flatbed. And here's what we found. Across the board, if you look at all the first six basics, unsafe, fitness, maintenance, substance abuse, and fatigue, you can see that in each of those cases, the blue bar, which represents the flatbed segment, is significantly better in CSA scores than the rest of the industry. That was very, very interesting and surprising to me when we ran that. But you can see that last guy out there at the end on the cargo violations, they are very significantly worse performers when it comes to cargo. And that was the unfair bias that the FMCSA intended to address. So they believed it was there. Everybody in the industry felt it in their gut. And we can now validate that with the data to show that, in fact, that unfair bias did exist. Next slide. So with the what and the why behind us, we're going to now look at what I'm going to do is a quick analysis here of the world as it exists today under 2.2. And then we're going to do exactly the same thing. We're going to wave a magic wand and create a world of 3.0. And then we're going to look and see exactly what has changed. So this first slide is just showing the frequency and severity of violations and their resulting CSA points. I call these the CSA points in play. So if you take all of the violations, take the severity weights of all of those violations, and then take the product, frequency times severity, you get a number. That's the big red bar. It's how many of them are there, and what are their severity weights, and how many CSA points does that put into play in the various basics. So you can see in descending order, maintenance, fatigue, unsafe, cargo, fitness, and then finally, controlled substances is almost invisible off the end as it tapers off. So you can say clearly here what CSA is creating is very much focused on maintenance, fatigue, unsafe, and to a certain extent, the existing cargo violations, and then it drops off pretty much into an abyss with fitness and substance. Next slide. So with that in mind, we're going to now dissect specifically the two basics that are relevant to these proposed changes, and that is maintenance and cargo. So again, we're in today's existing world. How does it look today? What this chart is showing are the top 10 violations measured by that same frequency and severity number. How many CSA points are we talking about? And I want to call your attention to a couple of numbers. Scratch them down on a notepad in front of you or keep them in your brain. It's going to be interesting to see just the sheer volume of numbers in the maintenance basic versus the other basics when we take a look at those. So you can look, if you look, for example, at the first, actually, Sloan, would you back up one slide? I'm sorry. It's a better way to look at the number. So just look, for example, down at the CSA violation points that are in play under the vehicle maintenance. You're up well over 300,000 CSA points, going down to about 1,600,000, 285,000 for cargo. Okay, now go ahead. So you kind of see the magnitude. It's not that important that you know the exact numbers, but you can see those are very high numbers in the hundreds or high tens of thousands. So let's just now peel back and look at just the top 10 vehicle maintenance violations as they exist today, and we're going to look specifically at two things. First, we're going to look at the average severity weight. So if you take the severity weights, that's that number right along the axis line there. You can see there's an 8, a 4, a 6, a 2, etc. Take those 10 numbers and average them, and you get a 4, 4.0 exactly. So when you look at vehicle maintenance, the first thing that we ask ourselves is, are these real severe things? Are these things that are, you know, on a scale of 1 to 10, how scary are these things? And the vehicle maintenance basics the vehicle maintenance violations, the top 10, average out at a severity weight of 4. Now, I then have applied another analysis that I call safety related. And this is open to discussion, and you may or may not agree with me, but I think it's reasonable. So here's what I've done is I've looked at those top 10 violations, and I've just asked myself, if I'm sitting down and I'm just having a conversation with somebody knowledgeable about the industry, are these things that we would probably agree have a nexus, if you will, a relative impact on true safety? And if you look at what they are, there's things like bald tires, hoses not secure, and a lot of lamp violations, things like that. Reasonable people could probably agree that when those things are not functioning or not present on a vehicle, the chances of it having an incident that leads to a crash, injury, or fatality are probably reasonable assumptions to make. So out of those top 10 vehicle maintenance violations, I assign that 10 out of 10 of them are safety related. That's my judgment. Okay, next slide. So now let's go, again, current CSA world, the world we're in today, let's do the same analysis for the existing cargo basic. Well, you can see immediately that the severity weight went up a bit. We went from a 4.0 to a 6.4. So the severity weights within the cargo violations appear to be a bit higher. However, the safety-related nature of those top 10, I only assign 7 of those to be truly connected to safety. And the reason is, if you look out towards the end, I think it's position number 7, 8, and 10 are things like shipping papers, placards. I think there's 2 placarding violations and a shipping paper. I'm going to proceed with this analysis with the assumption that shipping papers and placards don't cause crashes, injuries, and fatalities. Now, at the end of this, I'm going to share with you what the agency's argument is for doing this, and you can judge that on its merits. But I'm going to say that as we look at the cargo basic today, it's about 70% related to safety and has a reasonably high severity weights attached to those violations. In other words, it's important. It's things that really do hurt people. Things leaving the truck without permission are not a good thing. All right, Sloan, next slide, please. All right, now we're going to wave our magic wand. We already talked a little bit about the specifics here, so we're now going to wave our wand and go to a world of CSA 3.0, and we're going to go back and do that same analysis and have a look and see where the world looks once this becomes the live system. Next slide, Sloan. All right, so now what we're going to do, again, is we're going to look at the same basic view, but this time cargo is gone and hazmat is in. So you can see that really the only thing that has changed, vehicle still number 1, fatigue number 2, unsafe, and now hazmat takes the place of cargo. But you can see what it's done. I don't know if you remember those numbers. This is where it would be interesting to compare, but you're looking at something a little bit less than 90,000 CSA points that are in play in the hazmat basic. Remember that number was something like 230,000 for cargo. So we have taken it down by nearly a third, or taken it down to only about a third of the total points that are being written up on violations around the country. So it got, first of all, much smaller. There's simply many, many fewer violations and CSA points to be distributed looking at the new hazmat basic. Next slide. Okay, now we'll do the same thing. We're going to look at the details behind maintenance, and then we're going to look at the details behind cargo. So first, maintenance. So let's revisit the same thing. Let's look at the average severity weighting. It's a 4.0. And let's look at how many of those are safety related. Now remember, what have we done? We have taken hundreds, or well over 100, cargo violations out of the cargo basic and carried them over and dropped them into this vast ocean of vehicle maintenance. So you look at this and you say, well, Steve, those numbers look about the same. We have an average severity weight of 4. 10 out of 10 of them are safety related. So what happened here? Well, I can tell you that if you took this slide and held it up next to the one that we looked at previously, they are identical. They are exactly the same top 10 violations. And the point of this being that the frequency small relative to the frequency of all these maintenance violations. They simply, as I say, have dissolved in the vast ocean of vehicle maintenance, never to be seen again. This next slide illustrates that very clearly. So what I had to do here, I'll explain what this is trying to show. Imagine that you didn't just look at the top 10, but you took all of the violations and just laid them out in descending order on their frequency and severity. And let's see where, it's not in the top 10. We have to get at position number 41. So we'd have to run the top 41 vehicle maintenance violations before we discover the first of those new cargo citizens that's moved over to maintenance. And it's right there. Now, there are only 1,253 of those violations. That's over a two-year period for that particular violation. Now, remember, again, just sheer numbers. Look back at the numbers we're looking at for some of these maintenance violations in the high tens or hundreds of thousands of points in play. And here we had only just barely over 1,000 violations written on this first cargo basic that appears. And I can tell you that if you extended this on into the next tier from 41 to, say, 50 or 100, you still find very few of the cargo violations appearing until you get well into the about the 60s and 70s, and then you start to see the cargo violations start to pop up. But by then, they are so unweighted in terms of frequency that they are, as I've said before, virtually now invisible to CSA. So towards the goal of removing the unfair bias against flatbed carriers, mission accomplished. The cargo violations have become a non-issue in CSA. Next slide, please. So we looked at this back, we started looking at this back in February and doing some analysis on it before the preview site came out. And at the time, I did a blog, some of you may have seen, where I started discussing some of this and we could see what was going to happen. At the time, we didn't know that the 115 new violations were going to come in, but that obviously happened with the preview. But what I thought might happen, I posed in my blog, I said maybe what they'll do in order to correct this massive dissolving effect into vehicle maintenance, maybe what the agency will do is they'll have to pump up the severity weights of many of those cargo violations, and that'll bring them up into the forefront, put them on the radar, so to speak. So the preview came out. We took a look at it. Well, I was partly right. They did do a lot of reweighting of the cargo violations, but they did it in exactly the opposite direction that I would have expected. Every single cargo violation, with only one exception, I'll explain, every cargo violation that moved over to vehicle maintenance was de-weighted, some very significantly de-weighted. So if you look at this down the leftmost column of that table, all of those violations, and again, these are all previous cargo violations, all of the ones that were in the failure to prevent movement category were de-weighted from an 8 to a 3. General securement, 7 to a 1. Improper load securement went from 10 to 7. 7 to 1, 8 to 3. Here's the one exception. Towing or pushing a loaded bus. So in other words, you've got passengers on a bus and you are towing and pushing it. That was a 10, it remains a 10. I sort of think we ought to start an effort to actually remove that from CSA and make it a capital offense myself. That's pretty crazy. So that one appropriately stayed very highly weighted. Other than that one violation, everything else was very significantly de-weighted. So this is perplexing to me that we could have given the flatbed all the relief they needed without doing this. I really don't understand. I don't have a good theory as to why, in addition to putting them into this, throwing a cupful of water into an ocean, in addition, they de-weighted everything. So if it wasn't going to disappear by itself, they made sure they disappeared. So you can see the magnitude of some of those are decreases, down 63%, down 86%, 30, another 86. Here's a little story I like to tell here. Shortly after World War II, the United States Navy was faced with the daunting prospect of decommissioning a large number of warships that were no longer needed. They were too expensive to maintain and keep. They didn't need them. So they began a program of some of them they cut up and, and, you know, recycle the steel. Some of them they'd use as target practice, and some of them they'd go out and sink as artificial reefs, things like that. And the Navy came up with a designation when a battleship was or a warship was going to be decommissioned. And the designation they gave it was capital A, capital T, hyphen 6. And that is what became known as when you want to get rid of something, you 86 it. Well, you can see here we have 86'd cargo into the ocean of maintenance. They're gone. Next slide. So that's what happened. That's the result of in terms of cargo. So I asked myself, okay, well, I'm kind of scratching my head here, and I'm looking at this, and I'm thinking, I understand the reasoning, and I understand the need to give relief to the flatbed segment. That was called for sure. But boy, it sure looks to me like we took some significantly serious violations, real, true safety-related violations, and really went to great lengths to make them disappear from everybody's radar screen. You know, the old saying, I think, Sloan, this is a saying I hear you say from time to time, if everything is important, then nothing's important. So when you remove things from focus, they simply become unimportant. People are not going to focus on things that aren't causing them pain in CSA. So you ask yourself, well, boy, we must get something really cool in return. There must be some great new, real great safety tool that we're going to get, because remember, we're trying to advance our ongoing mission here to reduce crashes, injuries, and fatalities on the highway. So what is this wonderful new safety tool that we now have that replaces cargo? And here it is, the new, I give to you the new HAZMAT BASIC and its top 10 violations. So first, let me call your attention to the bottom line and look at the numbers we're talking about. So whereas in maintenance, we're talking about hundreds of thousands of CSA points in play, and even in the old cargo, they were tens of thousands and hundreds of thousands in a couple of cases. And look at the number of CSA points that we're talking about in the top 10 HAZMAT violations. It's on the order of thousands, not tens of thousands, certainly not hundreds of thousands. It's a few thousand and drops off very quickly. So first of all, we have very thin data. There's very little data available to inform the HAZMAT BASIC relative to the others. At least the other important ones. Fitness and substance drop off pretty quick as well. But here's what's really interesting here. Look at the average severity weighting of these cargo violations. Their average severity weighting is a 5.1. You remember maintenance was a 4.0, cargo was a 6.4. So it kind of sits in between those. There's a couple there that number 2 has a severity weight of 10, so that must be fairly serious. But when I attach my safety-related analysis to this, I only find one, and it is that second one, package not secure. Everything else, the other 9 on the top 10 hit list here, every single one of them is placards, paperwork, shipping papers, every single one. So if I'm in negotiating, if this was a business arrangement and I'm negotiating to give up cargo violations and I want to get something else that's very safety oriented in return, I think we got a really lousy deal. I don't believe, this is Steve's opinion, it's my webinar, I get to have my opinion. My opinion here is we have made a bit of a deal with the devil. So while it is true that the flatbed segment needed relief, they have, in my opinion, gotten too much relief, and what we got in exchange is compliance. Compliance on things like, my favorite here is that the placard does not read horizontally. Now, I don't know about all you guys, but I don't lay awake at night worrying about whether somebody's placard reads horizontally. I might lose a little bit of sleep over a roll of steel coming loose off of a flatbed and rolling down the highway. That would cause me a little bit more concern. So this is what we got in exchange for doing away with the cargo violations. We got a new basic that is solely dedicated to the prospect of paperwork and compliance. Next slide. So let's just kind of review what we've found here, and then we'll wrap it up and take some questions. But just to review what we found, there was an unfair bias against flatbeds. That's gone. Mission accomplished, FMCSA, the bias no longer exists. And I have spoken to a large number of our customers who are those flatbed carriers, and there's lots of smiles and happy faces. It truly has left the stage, exited stage left, in terms of an issue for the flatbed carriers. What was previously the number one cargo violation appears now in position number 41 in the vehicle maintenance basic. Again, completely off the radar. The amount of data on HAZMAT at large, and specifically on the 118 new HAZMAT violations that were added, is almost non-existent. It is, you know, we look at a lot of data at Vigillo, and we are constantly, testing ourselves to make sure that when we say things that we believe we see in the data, that we have sufficient data to be making those kinds of statements that we do. I don't believe there's enough data here for the agency to use this as a measure against carriers, never mind whether they're safety related or not. And by the way, the agency clearly admits that they understand. They make no claim at all that the HAZMAT basic is predictive of crashes or will in any way reduce injuries or fatalities. They just simply say compliance is important and we want to measure it too. And I will just say, once again, revisit the mission statement of CSA. There's nobody saying that they shouldn't enforce all of the regulations. And if HAZMAT compliance is something that they feel is getting a little bit squishy out there, there's all kinds of things they could do to introduce programs to focus on HAZMAT compliance. In my opinion, CSA is not the place to do that. CSA was designed to focus on the predictive nature of violations towards reducing crashes, fatalities, and injuries, and the HAZMAT violations do not accomplish that. The next one there was, remember, a wholesale reweighting, decreasing of all of the cargo violations. This is probably, to me, the biggest mystery in this. I have not heard a good explanation as to why they've done this, but they clearly have. The new HAZMAT basic, as I've said, is focused solely on placards and compliance. They are not safety issues, in my opinion. And then we can go on to what are the unintended consequences. The one not necessarily stated here, but I think the biggest unintended consequence will be we just made the roads less safe. By taking our eye off of serious cargo violations and putting our eye, we only have so many eyes, there's only so many law enforcement people, there's only so much training and focus that can be done on CSA, and we have now put placarding and compliance up front of serious cargo violations. In addition to that, I believe the data sufficiency, as I just mentioned, gives very odd results. When you have a system of numbers, if you're looking at statistics, and you don't have sufficient data, any one little change, you know, one new violation, one more thing happens, maybe you get a couple of more violations over that two-year period, very small changes to the data can have very dramatic spiking effects on carrier CSA scores. The final one is we got rid of the unfair bias up top. The unfair bias against flatbed carriers is gone. We have traded that for a new unfair bias. So what we have found is that if you are a carrier who does not specialize in HAZMAT, so you're not a tank truck or you're not hauling explosives or things like that. You're a carrier that will occasionally carry a HAZMAT package around in the back of your truck. And there's lots of people out there that do that. If you are one of them and you're a larger carrier in that group, this thing is really tough on you. We have heard from carriers all over the country. Large carriers don't specialize in HAZMAT, and for the first time, many of these are seeing that they've got the alert symbol on a basic, and they've never seen alert symbols before. So these are some of the largest, best run, safest operators in the country, and suddenly they're over threshold in this new HAZMAT basic. I don't believe that it was the intention of the FMCSA to suddenly focus on those large, safe, well-run operators. I will refer back to a saying by one of my heroes, Obi-Wan Kenobi, when in Star Wars the stormtroopers were looking for his droids, and he used the Force to tell them that these are not the droids you're looking for. And I would suggest that these large non-specialty hazmat carriers are not the droids that the FMCSA should be looking for, and yet they are the very ones that are showing up now on the hazmat radar. And next, and I believe last slide, we're just going to revisit one more time what it is. Oops, I'm sorry, I forgot. Sloan, you can probably flip through those. There's some product slides. That's our opportunity to do a little commercial and talk about how great our products are. I'm going to skip that here today. And this is now the last slide. This comes directly off of the FMCSA's website as of yesterday. It's still up there. They still have it up there as the justification for doing CSA. And if many of you have probably seen this slide before, what this is showing is the fatalities per 100 million vehicle miles traveled going back to 1975. And you can see that over the years, through all kinds of initiatives and safety efforts and better technology, et cetera, those fatalities kept coming down, 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 down. And then right in the early 2000s, it flattened out. That is where that's what gave rise to CSA. It was in 2004 when the design work began on CSA. Again, what is the mission? To get that trend going back down again. That is what the FMCSA stated their mission was. They've now stated it in three different mission statements, backwards, current, and forwards. This is the chart they still have on their website. They've now redesigned CSA, and they have drifted from their mission, in my opinion. So that is the presentation and the analysis. I think, Sloan, if you've gotten some questions, maybe we can begin to take those now.
Absolutely. We'll get to the questions in just a second. What I wanted to say, first of all, if you do have questions and haven't gotten a chance to enter them, remember there's that orange button and that bar on the side. Just type them into the chat. We'll answer as many questions as we can here. I'll take them to Steve, and then if we can't get to the questions, we'll follow up individually as well. So there were a couple questions, Steve, on the timing of these SMS 3.0 changes. Will there be additional changes? What's happening in the future with them?
Yeah, that's an excellent question, and I'll tell you what I know, and I may not know everything. I'm pretty sure I don't. So this preview was released, and I will give credit where it's due. I don't know of any other federal agency who regulates an industry and is as willing to take feedback and do something like the preview site. That took time, resources, probably a great expense to build that site they have with the sole purpose of saying, when we make changes to CSA, we want to give people the opportunity to see how it's going to impact them, to evaluate that impact, and to comment on them. So that's a good thing, and I don't want to just beat up the FMCSA. So I'll give them a plug there. So the preview went live in March. So if you haven't gone in and looked at your own preview site, log into SMS. There's a link to it. I don't know, Sloan, if we can put on the blog maybe a couple of helper screens to show people how exactly to get there if you're not familiar with it. But I would encourage everyone to log in and look at your preview, and it will show you exactly for your individual carrier how you will look under the 3.0 methodology. So that happened in March. What they have stated is they're going to use that preview to release changes to CSA up to two times a year, no more than two times a year. So this is time number one for 2012. Here's the way that we've been instructed that it's going to work. They'll put the preview up. They'll let it sit there for probably around 60 days. They'll have about 60 days where they'll take comments. After that period, we don't know what's going to happen exactly. So at one point in time, the preview site said that after the preview period and after comments, the preview would become the real site on July 28th. Now, that July 28th date went away, and now they just say summer of 2012. So it's a little bit ambiguous. I don't know exactly what's going to happen. What I do know is the period for carriers and others, interested parties, to submit comments on these proposed changes is the 28th of May, this month, a few days from now. So once that's passed, your opportunity to comment on this would be lost. So if there's one takeaway that I would encourage everybody, it's to look at your preview site, look at your scores, think about this, do your own analysis. You can take what I say, you can do your own analysis. We're going to be posting a comment of our own. We'll put that up on the blog this weekend and let people weigh in and see what they think of that before we post it. But we intend to do our own posting, and I would encourage every carrier out there to do the same.
Thank you, Steve. A couple of questions about slides and recording. We are recording this webinar. We will post the recording and the slides on the Vigillo blog likely within the next day or two. That's at blog.vigillo.com. Steve, the question is, can you talk about, again, the purpose of moving the non-HAZMAT cargo violations to vehicle maintenance? What was the purpose of that?
The purpose on its face was to give relief to the flatbed segment. They wanted to, that was their solution as to how to take away that unfair bias from the flatbed carriers. That's it. They say that right on their website. They're very clear. That's not my opinion. That's their stated reason for doing this. The secondary reason is they have said that the industry was requesting a HAZMAT basic, that there was a desire from some in the industry that apparently had been given feedback over the last year or so, that they thought it would be fairer if a HAZMAT-focused basic was created. So they were kind of killing two birds with one stone here: give relief to the flatbed carriers and create a new HAZMAT focus.
Okay, quite a few questions coming in now. Another question. So for a company that has a high cargo score and a moderately high maintenance score, would this push them over the threshold?
Yeah, that's going to be case by case, possibly. So again, if you think about the impact, again, I'll just use my perhaps a poor analogy, but even with high cargo scores, it's still a little cup full of water being thrown into a large ocean. But not every carrier, a carrier is not a carrier is not a carrier. So everybody's going to be a little bit different. Again, I would strongly encourage everybody to look at your preview site. You can answer that question for yourself today if you're a carrier and you have a DOT number and a login to SMS.
Here's an interesting one. Will the change severity weights be applied retroactively to violations within the last 2 years?
The answer is to that would be yes. Once this system goes live, if in fact it goes live, by the way, the one thing I didn't mention that is fairly important, the other thing they're going to do when this HAZMAT basic is created, it will become publicly available. So whereas today, 5 of the 7 basics are available to public view, now 6 of the 7. Only crash will be kept private. That's the current proposal. So that's a little aside there. Sorry, Sloan, tell me the question again.
That was it. Will severity weights be applied retroactively?
Oh, yeah, right, so severity weights. So as soon as this happens, as has always been the case, whenever there's a change to CSA, it is a backward-looking system that goes back 2 years for the carrier score, and whatever change they make will look backwards 2 years and make all those same changes apply to all the violations. So the answer is yes, it will look back retroactively and apply the new severity weights.
Gotcha. Here's a good question about a carrier that's currently classified as HAZMAT and the HAZMAT thresholds. So our thresholds are currently based on the fact that we are listed as a HAZMAT carrier, so they're lower than those carriers that are not HAZMAT carriers. With the new HAZMAT basic, will the thresholds, those HAZMAT thresholds, be adjusted so we are not penalized twice for this item?
Yeah. That's an excellent question, and it is a little bit complex to try to get into on a webinar. I'll try to just answer it at a high level, and then this is probably one we want to do some follow-up offline. But here's the way it works. You are correct. There are now going to be HAZMAT thresholds for the non-HAZMAT basics, and that'll be determined by the things that characterize you today as a HAZMAT carrier, yes or no. There is a different way of characterizing whether you are subject to the HAZMAT basic itself. And you may or may not be HAZMAT otherwise, but it's a different way of measuring. There's a different way they're going to determine whether or not the new HAZMAT basic applies to you. So we could probably write a short white paper on how all that works, but it's rather complex. But the issue is you may or may not be a HAZMAT carrier for purposes of the the other basics, and you may or may not be a hazmat designated for the new hazmat basic, and they're not the same.
Yeah, that's likely to cause some confusion, I imagine.
It is.
The questions are rolling in, so again, we're going to do our best to keep getting to questions. We probably are not going to get to all of them, though, but there's still quite a few great questions here. So one is sort of two parts. One, has Vigillo presented this data to the FMCSA? And following up, this questioner says, as of yesterday, there were 12 public comments on this FMCSA proposed change. How critical is public comment in getting the agency to reconsider proposed changes?
All right, so yeah, I can answer that. There's two questions in there. Have I presented this to the FMCSA? I have not directly had the opportunity to sit down with FMCSA people and give them my analysis. I have, however, presented this a number of times in the last 60 days or so at several industry events, state association meetings, safety meetings, places like that. I have visited several of our customers and have done this directly with a few of our customers. And in many of those settings, FMCSA people were in the room. So while it was not done, you know, for the purpose of them taking my analysis, they I believe, are very very aware of where Vigillo stands on this. I did, to get to part two of the question, how important are the comments, one of the presentations I made recently was to the Alaska Trucking Association. It was up in Anchorage, and Administrator Farrow was there at the meeting as well. And I got some time to speak to her alone. I did give her my take on this. I didn't go through this whole analysis, but I did share with her my concerns. She then got up and made a plea to the crowd to please, please, please submit comments. And I think she's sincere. I do believe that if there's an opportunity to impact this, perhaps to have it revisited, retooled, or at the very least, not be made public, I believe that they are listening, and the more comments, the better.
Okay. Another question is, where can I get more information about hazmat qualifications? What makes us a hazmat carrier for lower thresholds? What makes you eligible for the hazmat basic?
How about this, Sloan? Let's do a blog on that specific topic. I think that's probably worth doing.
Yep.
So let's you and I work something up in the next 24 hours or so. I could. It's a little technical and it can be a little complicated, but let us take a shot at writing up a response to that. We'll get it up on the blog here, and I think we probably have everybody's email from who's attending. As soon as
right.
we have that up, we can do an email and alert everybody that we have. I think that's. That's a great question. It's a little bit technical to just try to do talking about it on the phone. I think we ought to put together a page or two on it.
Sure. And there's a lot of questions, so we're not going to get to all of those, but I think we have time for one more if you're available still, Steve.
Sure.
Yep. And this is, hazmat seems to be another driver fitness-like category. Why not put those hazmat placards and such there?
I think that's an excellent idea. I think there's any number of things that could have been done to again, accomplish the goal of giving the flatbed segment some relief and staying true to the mission of CSA, which is to reduce crashes, injuries, and fatalities. I don't think all this paperwork and placarding, I don't think it belongs in CSA, period. Again, fine, go enforce the regs, no problem with that, and put a program around hazmat if you like, but don't put it into CSA. It dilutes its mission. It gets us off the rails with CSA and gets all of us focused on the wrong thing, not safety.
Oh, okay. Steve, any last comments, questions for people?
I just would leave everybody. I hope that was useful and worth your time, and again, would encourage everybody to give this some thought and post your comments. Comments don't have to be long, sophisticated articles. It's okay to just put up a few thoughts. Try and, you know, obviously be respectful and be thoughtful, but I think the more comments we can get up there, the better. I don't think 12 comments is going to get much done.
So just before the end here, a couple notes. We will send a follow-up email, so you can look for, and it'll give you information about the video of the recording, the slides available for this on Vigillo's blog. Again, if we didn't get to your question, I apologize. We will follow up individually. Again, I hope this was useful, and have an excellent day. Do continue to watch the Vigillo blog. This is a hot, hot area. We are posting a lot of information every week. So thanks so much, and have an excellent day. Take care.